Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Your Defiant Teen, 10 Steps to Resolve Conflict and Rebuild Your Relationship, by Russell A. Barkley, PhD, and Arthur L. Robin, PhD, with Christine M. Benton. Narrated by Barry Abrams. Introduction.
Slam.
That's the sound of teenage defiance. You may be hearing it on a regular basis when your son storms out the door following yet another battle of wills. Or perhaps you imagine it every day as you wait in dread for your daughter to decide that walling herself off in hostile silence at home no longer puts enough distance between her and you. Either way, it's a frightening noise. It's hard enough to deal with your home being turned into a battleground, agonizing over what might happen to a son or daughter you can no longer control can keep you up at night and break your heart. This book is about how you can become a positive influence in your teenager's environment again, rather than just part of the place your son or daughter chose to slam the door on. It's about how you can get your teen to follow the non-negotiable rules for living in a civilized family, and how you can learn to negotiate the rest of the issues you have with your teenager. It's about shedding those entrenched beliefs about each other. He's purposely baiting me. You never let me do anything with my friends, as if I'm like 10, that only end in no-win battles. It's about giving teenagers skills that will enable them to achieve successful adulthood and serve them well for a lifetime. About getting to the point where you might hear, "So how can we fix this?" instead of, "I'm out of here." If you've picked up this book, you may already know that when every interaction with your teenager erupts into a fight, something is wrong. You're probably no longer comforted by your own reassurances that your teenager is just going through a rebellious phase. If any of the following scenarios sound like what's going on in your family, it's time to take action to reverse a trend you're beginning to fear will never reverse itself. Kevin is 15. Neighbors who were worried about what might be going on next door told his parents that their son was coming home at lunchtime a couple of days a week with his girlfriend and never going back to school. Loud music, noises, and laughter coming from Kevin's bedroom window made them think that Kevin and his girlfriend were drinking and having sex. His grades were decent, and his standardized test scores were off the charts, so his parents hoped he was just going through some phase. But when they found empty beer cans and used condoms in the trash, they realized they'd been downplaying their fears and finally confronted their son. A horrific argument broke out, during which Kevin screamed profanities at his parents. Lauren's mother describes the 14-year-old as completely changed since elementary school, wistfully wondering where her sweet little girl went. Lauren hardly speaks to her these days, except to make some snide comment about what she's wearing, or to yell back at her when her mother's unsuccessful cajoling finally erupts into a shouted command. One night recently, when Lauren's mom got up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom, she peeked in on her daughter, as she always used to when she was small, only to find her on the internet, talking with a strange man in another state. When she told Lauren to immediately turn off the computer, a huge argument resulted, replete with accusations and cursing. Lauren's father woke up and broke up the argument, taking away Lauren's computer and smartphone privileges for 3 months. Gina is only 13, yet she is failing 3 of her 5 eighth-grade classes. When her mom asks her whether she has any homework, she claims she's already done it in school and just forgot to bring it home. "Not so," said her teacher. So mom grounded Gina on weekends, confining her to her room, where she was to make up missed assignments or study for tests. Gina sneaked on her smartphone and sent text messages to her friends instead of doing her homework. Her mother removed the phone, with Gina shouting and cursing. Now Gina just daydreams all weekend, getting little work done. mother and daughter argued daily about school and homework. 17-year-old Mark skips school, comes home drunk on weekends, and doesn't try to hide the smell of marijuana smoke wafting from his room at night. When his parents confront him about all of these violations of their rules, he typically curses at them, threatens to hit them, and storms out, accusing his parents of child abuse. His truancy is beginning to threaten his chances of getting a high school diploma. His mother says she can't force him to go to school by driving him there because he just runs away when she tells him to get in the car or leaves the school grounds after she drops him off. His father says he can't get involved in the morning or he'll be late for work. These kids are not just suffering growing pains, and their parents are not control freaks prone to exaggeration. Mark's parents always knew they had a strong-willed son. When the curfew violations and smart-mouthing started in eighth grade, they tried to cut him some slack to avoid breaking his spirit the way his father felt his parents had done to him. When they look back over the last few years, they realize that the infractions gradually grew in frequency and seriousness, but they have no idea when this tough guy who thumbs his nose at them and their rules first showed up. Lauren's mother says her daughter started clamming up around her and doing mostly what she felt like doing a few months ago, when she started high school. Kevin's parents have tried everything they can think of to get control of their very bright son, removing privileges, setting an early curfew, grounding him, but he's been finding a way around their restrictions for a long time, and half the time their demanding jobs leave them too exhausted to fight these days. Gina has attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, and her parents had kept her on track by using timeouts, point systems, and medication since her diagnosis at age 9. But now she refuses to take her medication and doesn't seem to care half the time whether she loses screen time or earns points for a pizza party. During timeouts, she sits silently and smirks. Teenagers can become defiant for a number of reasons. It's worth exploring what may be going on if your child has made a sudden transformation and the behavior hasn't been going on for long. In Chapter 1, we'll tell you how to figure out whether there's a physical or other undisclosed factor at work. But regardless of the cause, the program in this book may be the solution you're looking for. Psychologists consider a teenager in need of help when one or more of these three conditions exist. 1. The teen's behavior is much worse than it is for most kids of the same age. How does the teen you're concerned about compare to other teenagers you've raised, or other teens in your extended family or in the neighborhood? What reports do you get from other parents, teachers, and other adults in a position to supervise your son or daughter? We'll give you some questionnaires and checklists with which to assess your teenager in Chapter 1. 2. The teen's behavior is making it hard for him or her to function as expected. Like Kevin, your teenager might be quite intelligent but still unable to maintain good grades, positive friendships, or good family relationships. Maybe your teen doesn't seem to be able to take care of him or herself or to follow rules typically expected of teenagers without constant adult supervision. Or worse, maybe your teen's conduct is at risk of provoking serious consequences from others, such as being kicked out of school or being arrested for underage alcohol use. 3. The teen's behavior is causing a lot of emotional distress or harm. The distress is just as likely to be yours as it is the teen's. The point here is that if you and/or your defiant teenager are suffering a lot of anxiety, depression, or chronic unhappiness as a result of the teen's behavior, some action is required. What these three factors may add up to is a scenario like this. Your teenager seems to argue with everything you say, constantly breaks the rules, or lies to get around them. Maybe you regularly find yourself lying awake at night, alternating between states of terror and fury about your son's failure to get home by curfew. Again. Perhaps you're watching your daughter's grades drop, but get nowhere when you question the fact that she claims to have no homework. Again. Maybe you're becoming aware that your teenager is breaking the rules at home and at school, and now you're starting to wonder whether your child is flirting with breaking the law, too. Or maybe you're just tired of daily battles over what your teen is wearing, how the teen talks to you, the chores the teen is not doing, the mess the teen is leaving, and the kids your teen is spending his or her time with. Whether your problem is great or small, constant or periodic, this book can help. It can help you if defiance is entrenched or just beginning. It can help you whether you have an older teen or a preteen, and you want to know how to stave off problems during adolescence. The program you'll hear about in this book consists of 10 steps that can restore a positive relationship between you and your teen and greatly reduce the conflict that pervades your home life. It can improve your teen's academic performance by changing the way homework and other school matters that you can control at home are handled. We can't promise that it will obliterate all signs of defiance in your teenager, or even that it will work for all teens. But if you stick with it, we can't promise that it will obliterate all signs of defiance in your teenager, or even that it will work for all teens. But if you stick with it, you can expect your relationship with your teen to move in a more positive direction from now on. If your teenager was defiant as a child, and you have used the 8 steps in Your Defiant Child, some of this program will be familiar to you. Some of the principles are the same, from the importance of paying positive attention to your son or daughter to the usefulness of reward systems. But naturally, there are differences as well. After all, your son or daughter is no longer a child, can't be expected to respond like one, and should not be treated like one. This program is not going to restore the type of control you may have had when your child was 7 or 8. It will teach you how to take back the authority that is appropriate for you to retain over a teenager, while recognizing and respecting the growth and maturity that your teen is seeking and experiencing. This means more negotiation and less laying down the law. It means adding communication and problem-solving skills to the repertoire used in your interactions. The result of this program, ideally, will be that your teenager is no longer a tyrant controlling the environment in which your family lives. But at the same time, your teen will be acquiring valuable skills to take along into adulthood. We know this approach works for many families. 2 of us, Dr. Barkley and Dr. Robin, are clinical psychologists who have devoted our careers to the clinical care of children and adolescents with defiant behavior and ADHD. Both of us are also highly experienced researchers. We've conducted numerous studies on these 2 disorders and tested various treatment programs for their effectiveness in addressing the individual and family problems these disorders are likely to pose. More information on Dr. Barkley can be obtained at his website, russellbarkley.org. One of us, Dr. Barkley, specifically helped to develop the methods discussed here on behavior management of children and teens, including an emphasis on positive attending skills by parents, the use of privileges, point systems, and other organized incentive systems for encouraging appropriate pro-social behavior, and the incorporation of mild forms of discipline for dealing with defiant behavior. These treatment programs were based on those developed earlier by Constance Hampf, PhD, and were learned while training with her at the Oregon Health Sciences University in Portland. This work was later combined with Dr. Robin's program on problem-solving and communication training to study their effectiveness as a treatment package under 2 federally funded grants serving defiant teens and their families. Between us, we have more than 60 years of clinical and research experience addressing the problems of families with defiant children and teens. All the stories you'll find in this book are informed by those years of experience as well. They are fictionalized composites of problems and solutions we have seen in action time and again. We sincerely hope you and your teenage son or daughter will benefit from all we've learned. How to use this book. This book is divided into 2 parts. Part 1 helps you take a closer look at your teenager's defiance. What's really going on, and what factors have been contributing to the conflicts you're experiencing. This understanding alone can help you all start to make changes that reduce defiance. At the very least, they may increase your empathy for the teen who has become such a thorn in your side and give you hope that things can get better at home. What you learn about your teen, yourself, and the challenges you're dealing with that are causing conflict between you will serve you well when you start the program in Part 2. There you'll find 10 steps that break down what right now probably seems like an impossible task, starting to take back control over your teen's behavior, and in a way that allows your teenager to mature and gradually gain the independence that all teens must strive for. We strongly recommend that you listen to Part 1 before launching into the program. The understanding you gain in Part 1 is groundwork that will increase your chances of success with the program. It will also introduce you to lots of families like yours, so you'll remember that you're not alone in this struggle, and that there are creative ways of applying the lessons we've learned in our work. If you decide to follow the program in Part 2, you should plan on taking 3 to 4 months to get through it. In our work with parents, we usually allow 1 to 2 weeks per step so that the lessons and techniques of one step are firmly ingrained before the next one is added. You may be able to move more quickly. You'll be able to tell mainly by how comfortable you've become with using the new skills and changes in the general tenor of interactions at home. Whatever time you invest, remember what you stand to gain. You're not just getting a better relationship with your teen. You're shaping your son or daughter into an adult you can send off into the world with confidence and pride. If you follow the program in Part 2 and find that you are not getting results after 4 months, we strongly recommend that you enlist the help of a qualified psychologist or other mental health professional trained to use this approach. The book then becomes the assigned reading that accompanies the family intervention in which you are participating. Often, a psychologist familiar with this approach can help you make changes that were difficult to make on your own, even though the general approach is the same. Part 1. You and your defiant teen. 1. What defiance is and what you should do about it. 17-year-old Mark, mentioned in the introduction, usually doesn't show up at home on weekdays until dinner time, if then. So when he made a rare appearance at 3 o'clock one Friday, his mother Sandy looked at him suspiciously when he entered the kitchen, pointedly looked at her watch, and said sarcastically, "To what do I owe this honor?" Mark just sneered and opened the refrigerator. As she watched him pawing through the food on the shelves, Sandy became more and more irritated. She didn't want to start a fight. It had already been a long week. But she couldn't keep her silence. "Mark, did you actually go to school today? Doesn't the last class end at 3 o'clock?
"Relax, Ma. My last class was canceled. Besides, what the hell do you care? You haven't asked me about school since, like, Christmas."
"Watch your mouth, young man," Sandy snapped. "If you miss much more school, you're not even going to graduate."
"Oh yeah, like that matters."
Mark grabbed sandwich fixings from the refrigerator and plopped down at the kitchen table, where he started making 3 huge sandwiches.
"What do you need all that food for?" his mother demanded. "You get lunch money every week."
"Yeah, well, I spent it on cigarettes," Mark shot back,
then leaned back in his chair and aimed an insolent grin at his mother.
"Besides, I'm going to be out for a while. I'm taking this with me."
Sandy spun around from the sink.
"You're not going anywhere till you mow the lawn like I asked you last Saturday, and the Saturday before, and the Saturday before that."
"It's Friday, and I'm going out. You want the grass cut so bad, you do it. All you ever do is sit around here anyway."
"Don't you talk to me that way, and don't you even think about leaving here without cutting the grass."
"Okay, I won't think about it," Mark said slyly.
Then he stood up, went back to the refrigerator, grabbed a 6-pack of beer, and walked out the front door so fast he didn't hear his mother yelling,
"You get back here, Mark! Don't expect to waltz back in here whenever you feel like showing up. Everybody has to pitch in around here, you know.
Mark was thinking about his plans for the weekend and had already tuned his mother out. This scene, or one a lot like it, has been replayed in this household dozens of times over the last year. When Mark started to act as if his parents' rules were negligible and their requests optional, his parents said nothing, hoping the phase would pass. When it didn't, they tried threats and removal of privileges. Mark just laughed at them. Now he comes and goes as he pleases and treats them with more and more disdain. Periodically, he erupts into cursing and threats of his own. Frankly, both of his parents are a little bit afraid of him. How we define defiance. Pull this interaction apart, and you'll have before you all the elements by which we define defiance. 1. Failure to comply with an adult's request within a reasonable time. Believe it or not, a mere minute or so is considered a reasonable time within which to comply with an adult's request. That's about the same window in which you'd expect an adult to do something you've asked, and it's fair to expect a teen to do the same. Yes, if a teen is already busy with another project, then a longer time to comply is reasonable, but in those cases, the teen should at least acknowledge the request and an intention to comply with it within a minute or so. Mark not only didn't mow the lawn when his mother asked him, he's totally ignored her request for 3 weeks. 2. Failure to keep doing what has been requested until the task is finished. Maybe this seems like it goes without saying, but many teenagers start out doing what they're asked to do and then don't follow through. They pay lip service. They do half the job and then switch to something they want to do. They do a sloppy job. Or they drag out the task for so long that it doesn't get done when you need it done. Mark obviously never even got started. Of course, in some circumstances, it's clear that compliance with an adult instruction is not expected immediately, but in those cases, it's up to you to state explicitly when compliance should begin. 3. Failure to follow previously taught rules of conduct. Mark has racked up quite a score on this one. His parents expect him to attend school, let them know where he is, come home when expected, speak to them respectfully and listen attentively, and spend the money they give him as they intended, not for cigarettes and beer. He defies them on every count. Although we'll use the term defiance throughout this book, it's important to understand that we mean both non-compliance, passively not doing what is asked or expected or not completing it, and more active verbal or physical resistance, such as Mark's arguing, swearing, challenging, and threatening. It may very well be the latter that has brought you to this book, although 14-year-old Lauren, mentioned in the introduction, has driven her mother to seek help just by quietly breaking all the rules and generally making herself scarce. Why you need to know more about your teen's defiance. If your teen resembles Mark or Lauren or the other two adolescents depicted in the introduction, you already know enough to justify trying the straightforward steps in Part 2. You may not know enough, however, to get everything you possibly can from the program. First, you need to know whether this self-help program is really what you need and whether it's all you need. Is your teen's defiance a behavior or a trait? If we asked you to tell us what you mean by defiance, you'd probably be quick to define it as resistance, opposition, and disobedience. Complete disregard for whatever you request, demand, or instruct your teenager to do. You may even liken it to Groucho Marx's refrain in the movie Horse Feathers. Whatever it is, I'm against it. Of course, you might look at it that way only on good days, when you can summon up a sense of humor about the issue. On most days, your teenager's defiance is no laughing matter. Dealing with someone who always seems to want to resist or to fight and constantly displays contempt or aversion wears you down and beats you up. You want to get this kid in line and get your lives back to normal.
The trouble is, your lives may never get back to normal if you view the problem as something your teen is instead of something he or she does. As you can see from our definition of defiance, it's measured by specific acts. Yet, when those acts add up to what feels like endless grief for you, defiance in a teen can begin to seem like a personality trait instead of a behavior. Personality traits generally can't be changed very much, but behavior can be changed. If you view your teenager as just being defiant, you're sort of stuck with the condition, aren't you? It's this perspective that leads to finger-pointing of the "you always" and "why can't you ever" variety. It puts you at loggerheads and keeps you there. Yet, if you look closely at the way your teenager acts, you'll probably see that she isn't defiant as constantly as you may feel. She may not be defiant everywhere, with everyone, all the time, and in exactly the same way. Some kids are so defiant at home that their parents can't believe they don't act the same way at school. But they don't. Others are much more defiant with certain people than with everyone else, or when faced with certain demands. Defiance is often demonstrated to different degrees, but it all begins to run together and seems like one big rebellion to parents who are expecting it. When you become aware of these nuances, you gain information about what goes wrong and what goes right, and consequently, where to address the problem first and how to capitalize on the positives. Remember, behavior can be changed. Looking more closely at your teen's defiance will reveal the cracks in the behavior and help you see where you can wiggle your way in and make a difference. Is it just normal adolescent behavior or more serious problems? Your lives may also never get back to normal if you put the emphasis on back. Taking a closer look at the history of your teen's defiance and training a magnifying glass on the current behavior will help you see how easy it can be to confuse normal adolescents striving for autonomy with out-of-control rebellion. We'll get into this important topic more in the chapters that follow, but for now, try to keep in mind that there is a line. It's just that it gets pretty blurry in the heated battle of wills. And we all take a little time to adjust to these new creatures who are so eager to be shed of our supervision and care. If you can begin to see the difference between normal assertions of growing independence, the way kids typically behave when they hit the teen years, and how what we call defiance departs from that pattern, you won't make the mistake of trying to correct behavior that is just fine as it is, as trying as it can be. Remember what you stand to gain. When your patience has been pushed so far past its limits that you don't remember what calm feels like, it's hard not to view defiance as a one-way street. Your teenager defies you, the cause, and conflict erupts, the effect. Look more closely, though, and you'll be reminded that defiance is not just an action, it's a reaction to the person being defied or to a situation deemed intolerable. Technically, it's an interaction. Your teen cannot defy your instruction if no instruction is given, or break a rule if one has not been laid down previously and you do not react with anger or frustration at everything your teen does. Defiance doesn't occur in a vacuum or when a person is alone. It takes two to tango, as they say. This may be hard to believe considering that teens often express defiance through their absence. You tell your 15-year-old to do the dishes and then hit the books, and instead he hits the pavement, running. You've set a weeknight curfew of 10 p.m., and your daughter responds to your edict by staying out till midnight. Whether the teen is present or not, every act of defiance is a response to something you or some other authority figure has said. Defiance makes the interaction a conflict. It pits you and your teen against each other. It pulls you farther and farther apart over time. When you look closely at your teen's defiance, you'll see the damage it's doing to the parent-child relationship. We hope this realization will motivate you to keep at the program even when it's tough, because you have so much to gain. And we hope you'll remember that if you're part of the interactions where defiance occurs, it means you have a lot of power to make a difference. Fairly simple changes in your behavior may lead to big changes in your teen's behavior. In the introduction, we said that if you answered yes to any of the following questions, you probably need to address your teen's defiance. 1. Is your teen's defiant behavior much worse than it is for most other adolescents? 2. Is your teen's defiant behavior making it hard for him or her to function as expected? Or does it risk eliciting serious consequences from others? 3. Is your teen's defiant behavior causing a lot of emotional distress or harm? The rest of this chapter will help you examine the nature of your teen's defiant behavior so you know how to answer these questions. You'll soon have a chance to enter all the information you've gathered on a decision-making worksheet to help you determine whether you need help, and if so, whether self-help is likely to be enough or you need professional help. What does your teen's defiance look like? Defiance takes all kinds of forms in teenagers. Just to get an overview of what you've been dealing with, make note of the behaviors in the upcoming Defiant Behaviors list that you've been noticing recently. Feel free to download it from guilford.com/barkley16-forms. Notice the four categories of defiant behavior: verbal, V; physical, P; aggressive, A; and passive noncompliance, PN. How many behaviors in each category did you check off? Keep this in mind as we proceed through the rest of the book. We'll be suggesting different techniques to deal with different categories of defiant behavior. In Chapter 15, you'll learn to use communication skills to deal with verbal defiance. In Chapters 10 through 12, you'll learn to use contracts, point systems, and punishments to deal with physical and aggressive defiance. In Chapter 14, you'll learn to use problem-solving to deal with passive defiance, as well as elements of the other types of defiance. If you checked off any of the last five symptoms in the aggressive category, be sure to listen to the section, "Do You Need Professional Help?" later in this chapter. Defiant behaviors. Verbal. Yells, whines, complains, screams, insults, swears, lies, argues, humiliates or annoys, teases, cries, sasses, or talks back. Physical. Defies, throws tantrums, disrupts others' activities, steals, runs away. Aggressive. Physically resists requests or instructions, throws objects, destroys property intentionally, physically fights with others, carries or uses weapons, breaks into other people's homes or businesses, is cruel to others, is cruel to animals, lacks guilt or remorse, or seems to have no conscience. Passive noncompliance. Ignores requests, fails to complete routine chores, fails to complete school homework, ignores self-care tasks. Other. From Your Defiant Teen, 2nd edition, copyright 2014 by the Guilford Press. Is your teen's defiance much worse than defiance in other teens? Is your teen's defiant behavior much worse than it is for most other teens? To answer this question, we need a standard for other teens to which you can compare your teen. First, on a paper, jot down the word from the upcoming options that represents how frequently your teen exhibits the following three behaviors. Fails to comply with an adult's request within a reasonable time. Never, sometimes, often, very often. fails to keep doing what has been requested until the task is finished. Never, sometimes, often, very often. Fails to follow previously taught rules of conduct. Never, sometimes, often, very often. Second, fill out the conflict behavior questionnaire for parents, developed by Dr. Robin. Feel free to download it from guilford.com/barkley16-forms for later uses. Save your frequency ratings and your scores on the conflict behavior questionnaire for parents to use in the decision-making worksheet. Is your teen's behavior creating impairment? Is your teen's defiant behavior making it hard for him or her to function as expected at home, in school, or in the community? To help you answer this question, we have listed the major settings where defiant behavior may be a problem. Consider all the oppositional behaviors that you rated sometimes, often, or very often on the previous checklist. Taking all these behaviors into account, circle the ratings on the impairment rating form available on the website that represent how much these behaviors interfere with your teen's ability to function in each life activity. Feel free to download the form from guilford.com/barkley16-forms for later uses. Even if you circled often or very often only once, your teenager's defiant behavior is interfering significantly with his or her ability to function in a major life activity. As with your frequency ratings, keep your results handy so you can use them in the decision-making worksheet. Conflict Behavior Questionnaire for Parents. The following is another way to measure your teenager's defiance. If you wish, fill out this questionnaire and compare the results you get with those from the rating forms earlier in the chapter. Essentially consistent results should reinforce the decision you've made about what action to take. This form is also an excellent way to see whether your teen's problematic behavior occurs more with you or another parent or caregiver, such as a grandparent who plays a parenting role. When the teen's behavior, or perceptions of the behavior, differs significantly between parents, or is perceived differently by the two, you may have to take extra measures to fend off a divide-and-conquer strategy and to stay on the same page when working through the problem. If more than one adult plays a significant parenting role with the teen, all of these adults should complete this form. I am the child's mother or father. Think back over the last 2 weeks at home. The statements here have to do with you and your teen. Listen to the statement and jot down true or false for each statement. Answer for yourself without talking it over with anyone. 1. My teen is easy to get along with. 2. My teen is well behaved in our discussions. 3. My teen is receptive to criticism. 4. For the most part, my teen likes to talk to me. 5. We almost never seem to agree. 6. My teen usually listens to what I tell him or her. 7. At least 3 times a week, we get angry at each other. 8. My teen says I have no consideration of his or her feelings. 9. My teen and I compromise during arguments. 10. My teen often doesn't do what I ask. 11. The talks we have are frustrating. 12. My teen often seems angry to me. 13. My teen acts impatient when I talk. 14. In general, I don't think we get along very well. 15. My teen almost never understands my side of an argument. 16. My teen and I have big arguments about little things. 17. My teen is defensive when I talk to him or her. 18. My teen thinks my opinions don't count. 19. We argue a lot about rules. 20. My teen tells me he or she thinks I am unfair. From Your Defiant Teen, 2nd edition, copyright 2014 by the Guilford Press. Scoring and interpreting your results. 1. Add 1 point for each of the following items answered true. 5, 7, 8, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. 2. Add 1 point for each of the following items answered false. 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 9. 3. Add all of the points together. There are 2 ways to interpret the conflict behavior questionnaire for parents' summary score. 1. Compare your score to the mean scores that we obtained in our research for families in conflict and families without conflict. See which mean your score is closer to. Mothers, mean score for families in conflict equals 12.4, standard deviation equals 5.0. Mean score for families without excessive conflict equals 2.4, standard deviation equals 2.8. Fathers, mean score for families in conflict equals 10.5, standard deviation equals 5.0. Mean score for families without excessive conflict equals 3.2, standard deviation equals 3.0. 2. Use the following cutoffs for high scores. Mothers. Any score above 8 is definitely in the problem range, higher than in 98% of families without excessive conflict. Any score of 6 to 8 is probably in the problem range, higher than in 84 to 93% of those families. Fathers. Any score above 10 is definitely in the problem range. Any score of 7 to 10 is probably in the problem range. Impairment rating form. Answer the following statements with rarely, sometimes, often, or very often. In home life with the family. In social interactions with peers. In school. In community activities. In sports, clubs, or other activities. In learning to take care of him or herself. In play, leisure, or recreational activities. In handling daily chores or other responsibilities. From Your Defiant Teen, 2nd edition, copyright 2014 by the Guilford Press. Is your teenager's behavior causing a lot of emotional distress? Emotional distress comes in many different forms. Maybe your teenager's defiant behavior is making you or others in your family feel angry, frustrated, upset, depressed, and/or hopeless. This is a difficult experience to measure because each person experiences emotional distress differently. So your ratings in the emotional distress rating form are bound to be inexact, which is fine. Just try to rate the overall degree of emotional distress you and other family members experience on a typical day because your teen engages in the defiant behaviors that you've reported on our earlier rating scales. Feel free to download the form from guilford.com/barkley16-forms for later uses. Emotional distress rating form. Answer the following statements with none, very little, moderate, a lot, or very much. 1. Emotional distress that I experience. 2. Emotional distress that my spouse experiences. 3. Emotional distress that my other children experience. From Your Defiant Teen, 2nd edition, copyright 2014 by the Guilford Press. If one or more of the people in your family are experiencing at least moderate degrees of emotional distress because of your teen's oppositional behavior, you need to think seriously about trying the program outlined in this book or seeing a therapist. Setting a course of action. Now you have some measurements to help you see where your teen's defiant behavior has brought you. Use them to fill out the decision-making worksheet to help you figure out what to do about the problem. Our recommendations are general guidelines based on our clinical experience, not on research data. Feel free to download the form from guilford.com/barkley16-forms for later uses. Do you need professional help? The decision-making worksheet gives you a rough idea of whether you need self-help or professional help. If you have any doubts, listen to this book and try our suggestions first. If they don't seem to help after you make a decent effort, find a mental health professional. We have included information on how to find a qualified professional in the appendix at the end of this book. In broad strokes, your teen's defiance may require professional help, even if it's not quite that severe, but has been going on for so long that you can't begin to imagine disentangling it. If it's a more recent development, but is causing your child or you such huge problems, example, refusing to go to school, complete withdrawal from family activities or mealtimes, persistent sadness or depression, an abrupt change in your teen's personality, that school and home life are totally disrupted, you might also need professional intervention, at least to get you on the right track. But you can also look a little more closely at the specific behaviors of your teen. During the last year, has your son or daughter started physical fights or used a weapon, bullied others, demonstrated physical cruelty to animals or people, or committed crimes such as assault or burglary? Has your teen run away from home and been truant? If you answer yes to any of these questions, roughly corresponding to the last 5 symptoms in the aggressive category in the defiant behaviors checklist, you're dealing with a problem that is more than you can handle without expert help. Seek a professional evaluation. Your teenager may have conduct disorder, discussed in Chapter 4. If you find yourself having any doubts about the severity of your child's problems, talk to others who have had a chance to observe and interact with your son or daughter. Teachers, coaches, friends, parents. Is there more to the story? It's not unusual for parents completing the rating forms in this chapter to realize that things may not be as awful as they thought. Stepping back and looking at your teen's behavior objectively could reveal that the daughter who's driving you crazy isn't impaired by her actions or attitudes, meaning you need to figure out whether something else is going on that's causing her to behave differently. Or maybe you'll find that the son who is causing such tension between the two of you isn't really headed for the life of crime that has become your worst fear. Marcia's daughter, Julie, had started at a new high school following her parents' move 6 months earlier, but no one noticed that she wasn't adapting well until she started acting out at home. The defiance exhibited by Daryl's 13-year-old Jake has been pretty innocuous, like purposely leaving his clothes all over the house or having to be reminded 3 times to take out the garbage or to walk the dog. But Daryl can't see that his son's developmental needs are different today than they were just a few months ago and expects his son to act like the acquiescent kid he was before puberty. Marcia may get something worthwhile from the program in this book, even though her daughter is mainly reacting to a tough transition in her life. At the very least, learning to pay more positive attention to her daughter, instead of always focusing on her moodiness, may offer her the support that serves as a suit of armor for some kids when they go out into a harsh world. But giving her incentives to be more civil in her interactions with family members and others, and showing her respect by engaging in problem-solving the way 2 adults would, might also help her daughter develop the confidence to deal with the changes in her life. On the other hand, Marcia might consider whether her daughter is suffering from symptoms of depression and talk to Julie's doctor, if not to a mental health professional. Daryl can use Part 1 of this book to start examining his expectations regarding his son and adjusting them to jibe with Jake's developmental changes. The behavior management techniques at the beginning of our program will help Daryl keep his responses and his requests to his son reasonable. Once he's found that he can enforce non-negotiable household rules effectively, he and Jake can learn to communicate better and start negotiating the, well, negotiables, a right that all maturing kids should get as long as they show they can handle the responsibility of additional freedom. Meanwhile, the rest of Part 1 of this book will help both Marcia and Daryl figure out in detail what's going on with their teen's behavior so they know how to make the best use of the program in Part 2. Are you ready to take action? There's no doubt about it. Change is hard, and lasting change is even tougher to make. You may have no doubt that you want to reap the benefits of a change in your teen's defiant behavior, but it can be a challenge to get there. And it's easy to get discouraged when the path proves to be anything but a straight line. The fact is, we all need to go through a series of stages to implement any significant change in our lives. There's always a period of time when we have a problem but aren't quite ready to see it that way. You may have gone through several months or even longer of battling with your teen before reaching the point where you realized that this might not be a phase and that you want to do something about the conflict that's taken over your family. It's probably at that point that you picked up this book. Hearing these words is your way of preparing to start doing what it takes to make the changes you and your teenager need to make. Listening to the rest of Part 1 is a terrific and critically necessary start. But once you dive into the program, it's important to understand that you need to do your best to stick with it. As you'll learn at the beginning of Part 2, consistency is one of the hallmark principles behind successful behavior change. Your chances of hanging in there will increase if you keep in mind that you may take one step forward and two steps back sometimes, and you'll probably take a lot of sideways steps too. The path toward less conflict between you and your teen can look much more like a zigzag than a straight line. Don't be discouraged if you move back and forth for a while. Just keep at it. Taking action. Observe your teen's current behavior and think carefully about his or her behavior in the recent past. Then fill out the rating forms in this chapter. Pay attention to what the conflict behavior questionnaire for parents tells you about how conflict with your teen may differ between parents. Based on your answers, decide whether your teenager is truly defiant and whether this book might help. Determine whether you might need professional help in addition to this book. If so, find a qualified clinician to consult for an evaluation and possible treatment. Figure out where you are in the stages of change. 1. Do you feel defiance is a problem for you, your teen, and your family? If not, set this book aside for a while, but continue observing your teen's behavior and the interactions between you. If the problem doesn't resolve on its own within a few more weeks, come back to this chapter and complete the checklists again. If the problem really is the same or worse, listen to the rest of this book. 2. If you do believe defiance is a problem you need to address, finish listening to this book before deciding whether to tackle the problem on your own or with professional help. 3. If you're ready to take action, pay careful attention to Part 1. You're in the thick of the preparation stage. Your next stage will be action, working through the 10 steps in the program. Once you've learned all the skills and techniques, you'll be in the maintenance phase, keeping what you've learned in practice. Occasionally, you may slip into relapse, but that's perfectly normal and reversible. Just return to Part 2 and see where you can take a refresher course. We'll offer plenty of troubleshooting tips with each step that can pull you out of these slips and get you back on track. 2. How defiance develops. It's been a rough day for 14-year-old Jenna and her mother Marla. Jenna's been in a bad mood all day, giving her mother lip and attitude every time Marla makes a request. Nerves are frayed and tempers are short. Now it's 9 p.m., and as usual, Jenna has not started her homework and is wasting time texting her friends. "Jenna!" Marla yelled up the stairs to her daughter. "Stop texting your friends and start doing your homework right now!" Marla heard her daughter's door open. "Just a minute!" Marla waited expectantly for a minute and then tried again. "Jenna!"
"I said just a minute, Mom!"
Marla shook her head, took a deep breath, and then gave it one more try.
"I've been asking you to do this all evening, and now it's getting late and you're wasting time. It's your grades, you know, and you are failing math."
Jenna stuck her head out of her bedroom door, put her hand over her smartphone, and yelled back,
"I said I'd do it in a minute. I'm busy."
Infuriated by her daughter's nasty tone, and reminded that she also has been warning her daughter about her astronomical cell phone bills, Marla stomped up the stairs and banged on her daughter's door.
"What?"
her daughter yelled.
"What? What? You know what? Get out here this minute, young lady."
"Just a minute,"
Jenna hissed through the door. Furious now, Marla banged on the door again. Jenna ignored her. Finally, seething and feeling totally helpless, Marla screeched,
"We'll deal with this later, Jenna. You're in big trouble."
Marla charged back down the stairs, sank into a kitchen chair with a glass of wine, and felt tears welling up in her eyes. So this is what it feels like to be tyrannized by a 14-year-old, she thought. Exhausted and discouraged from these daily and repeated confrontations with Jenna, she thought back to when Jenna was 10, and she was so proud that she had a child old enough and eager to be a help around the house. What had happened since those days? Upstairs, Jenna was saying to her friend, "So tell me what happened with Jason." Score, Marla 0, Jenna 1, or maybe 100, if you count all the other times this week that a similar scene has unfolded in the Burton household. Defiance develops over time. Defiance doesn't develop overnight. More often than not, it's a behavior that has blossomed over time, sometimes over several years, from a pattern of interactions that at first seemed like parenting business as usual. Maybe your 9-year-old son seemed to love to test your authority, and so made you ask him 3 times to complete the most basic of chores, like picking up dirty clothes that had been thrown about his bedroom as if a tornado recently hit his room. Or your 4th-grade daughter constantly talked back to you, and you described her to friends as much snippier than your other kids. You found yourself yelling a lot whenever you had to tell her to do anything, anticipating her predictable resistance, sometimes even when you were just asking her for information, such as about whether she had soccer practice the next day or she liked the lunch you packed for her that day. As time went on, your interactions with your growing child seemed to get more and more unpleasant when there was even a hint that you wanted something from the child that he or she might not find acceptable. By adolescence, you might have racked up a history of thousands of hostile exchanges, and your teenager had now solidified a repertoire of defiant behavior and an attitude toward you, and possibly other adults, that was disrespectful at best, belligerent to say the least, and openly defiant and confrontational at worst. By the way, if your teenager's defiance really has popped up all of a sudden, you should consult a doctor to make sure there is no medical cause, and possibly a psychologist to determine whether some emotionally traumatic event that you're unaware of, such as bullying at school, sexual abuse, or the onset of drug abuse, has precipitated a radical change in behavior. Most defiant teens end up that way because they've learned there's something in it for them. For your teen, maybe it was simply the ability to get you off her back. Or perhaps she knew if she put off complying, she'd be able to socialize just a few minutes longer. Sometimes the initial benefit is just getting your attention. When parents are distracted and overwhelmed by other demands on them, as so many of us are, it's hard to pay the kind of attention to kids that instills positive social behavior. so their kids get it with negative behavior. When the parents reward the behavior with attention, naturally the child is going to use this strategy again and again. If the child feels the parent's attention is slipping away, the obvious response is to up the ante and advance to even more negative behavior. This is one way teenagers become chronically defiant. Another way, and one more likely to increase defiant behavior, is when parents find a child's disobedience intolerable and simply cave in to his or her demands. Let's say you ask your son to take out the garbage. He ignores you. Now you yell at him to do it. He ignores you again. You walk over to him and pull him up from the floor where he's ensconced in front of his computer and order him again to take out the garbage. He yells at you. You yell back at him. He shouts, "You never leave me alone when I'm watching a show," and runs up to his room, slamming the door behind him. You then take out the garbage yourself, if only to get it done and maybe instill peace in the household. As with Jenna, your son has accomplished what he wanted, to delay or entirely avoid doing the chore you assigned him. His yelling at you and running away got him what he wanted. The odds are extremely high that he then tried it again the next time he wanted to avoid doing what you asked. This pattern may have put down roots a few years ago. Now your son is a foot taller than you, he has a driver's license, and he is more likely to sneer at you contemptuously than smile during any encounter. After years of trying all different types of discipline, along with cajoling and rewarding, maybe you just let him do what he wants, which he does. Or perhaps your conflicts just keep escalating. One day when her daughter was 13, after an argument that got so loud that 5-year-old Tyler was sobbing and the 7-year-old twins were sitting nearby with their hands over their ears, Marla suddenly stopped herself in horror when she found herself charging toward her daughter with her hand raised. Jenna had emitted a string of obscenities aimed at her mother that Marla had never even imagined coming from her daughter. Maybe it was Jenna's sudden look of real fear that got to her, but she stopped herself before actually hitting her daughter. Both mother and daughter collapsed in sobs, and Marla begged her daughter's forgiveness, vowing never to raise a hand to her again. Jenna went off to bed, without doing the dishes that had been the bone of contention to begin with, and the two spent the next week dejectedly dragging themselves around the house, generally avoiding being in the same room. Coercion is the name of the game. We call this kind of behavior pattern coercion. It is the use of negative, aggressive, hostile, or otherwise threatening words or behavior to get others to do what you want. Jenna got out of doing her homework by instigating a screaming match. Marla got Jenna to stop screaming obscenities by threatening to hit her. Both used hostile emotions, raised voices, insulting or abusive language, and even physical force to achieve their goals. The problem, obviously, is that Jenna's behavior has been reinforced. It got her out of doing the dishes and capitulating to her mother's demands. She's going to use the tactic again, consciously or not. Marla's behavior ended the angry exchange, but only for now, and at what cost? If you're listening to this book, you'd probably say that all you really want is for your teenager to start doing what you want, at least some of the time, at least when it's important. But you may be out of ideas for how to get there. You've reached a state often known as learned helplessness. This occurs when none of your coping behavior seems to work and you are intellectually clueless as to what to do next and too emotionally drained to even bother trying to solve the problem. What you've learned that makes you feel so powerless is that every exchange with your teen proves again that you can't force him or her to do what you need done. You've learned that whatever you do, things seem to get worse. Here's a way to look at the coercive pattern of behavior between the two of you that may help you see how each exchange contributes to the feeling of learned helplessness. Request, okay, or request, no. Request again, okay, or Request again, no. Request a third time, okay. Or request a third time, no. Then force or give up. The number of times you repeat your request and the intensity with which you try to force your teen to do what you want has increased over time as your strategy has remained unchanged. So has how emphatic your teen's no has gotten. In many cases, the pattern becomes so predictable that the middle steps, or even the first one, are skipped altogether. Some parents find themselves jumping right to coming on like gangbusters the minute they approach their teen. They're braced for resistance, and so resort to defensive offense. Their teens are usually ready too, and may leap to the most extreme behavior, even though what's at stake may be something as small as whether homework is going to be done before or after dinner. When you've reached this point, you may feel completely trapped. But there is a way out. The way to reverse this cycle of coercive behavior is to stop giving in, but also to stop resorting to anger, empty threats, or force. Clearly, this is easier said than done, but that is where the program in this book comes in. It will help you increase your teenager's compliance by giving you something else to do in the face of defiance. You'll unlearn helplessness step by step. The four factors that contribute to defiance. Meanwhile, though, you can take heart in the fact that you came to this state of affairs through a winding path that misleads a lot of us. Coercion becomes the fallback position, and defiance gets entrenched not because you're a bad parent or your teenager is a bad kid. Instead, it's a product of four intertwined factors. The teenager's characteristics, the parent's characteristics, stress, parenting style. Your teenager's characteristics. Certain inborn characteristics like personality and temperament can set the stage for defiant behavior in a teen. Some teens are just more easily frustrated by events, anger faster, and may be more irritable, impulsive, inattentive, poorly self-controlled, and just plain emotional than others, as part of the normal variation in human personality traits. On top of those, there are developmental characteristics that come with the terrain of teenhood. The need to become more independent, to develop an identity separate from parents, and to prepare to leave the nest. Some behavioral upheaval is inevitable as a result of these strivings. In addition, some teens come with other inherent challenges, whether they are physical disabilities or psychological impairments like attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, bipolar disorder, depression, and other disorders that affect thinking, emotions, and behavior. All of these traits in a teenager will contribute substantially to the likelihood that a teen can become defiant. Why? Because all of them contain problems with emotion regulation. Anger is as much an emotion as fear or depression, and some disorders neurobiologically predispose teens to have far less emotional regulation ability than normal. Such disorders result in some teens being far more likely to exhibit defiant behavior than others. Other forms of psychological treatment, including medications, may be needed to help address a neurobiological predisposition to being so emotionally unregulated. Your characteristics. Just as your teenager has inborn personality characteristics, you do too. You also may be dealing with physical limitations that increase stress or alter your typical reactions to the challenges that maturing teens present. Let's say you suffer ongoing pain from a back injury, or you've been dealing with chronic anxiety. You're not going to have as much patience or energy for dealing with an impulsive, temperamental, or defiant teen as someone without these additional pressures. Then there's the question of fit. Maybe you're extremely neat and organized. If you have a teenager who's exactly the opposite, you're starting every day with the stage set for a clash. And like your teen, you can also be prone to psychological disorders such as anxiety, depression, and ADHD, any of which can contribute to your conflicts with others for the same reasons as noted for the same disorders in your teen. Again, where such disorders are present in the parent, other forms of psychological treatment and medications may be needed to help parents better regulate their emotions. You may also have certain deeply ingrained beliefs about your teen that color your every reaction to the teen's behavior. You may believe that if your daughter doesn't stick to the straight and narrow path as defined sharply by you, she will end up pregnant, drug addicted, and in jail. You may also have come to believe that your teen's entire mission in life is to make you miserable, that your son is worthless, or your daughter hopeless. If you hold such beliefs, you're going to have a hard time making the kinds of changes in your family that will begin to eliminate defiance. Psychologists call these exaggerated beliefs cognitive distortions. When we subscribe to them, they have a way of exaggerating our emotional responses and steering us away from constructive actions. Stress. There's stress all around us, and it bears on everyone. If you've recently experienced a significant loss, such as a death in the family, or you're struggling with legal or financial problems, marital conflict, or job pressures, this too will sap your patience and reduce your tolerance for even minor misbehavior. The stress may leave you quicker to punish, leading to increased conflict. Or you might react to stress by becoming withdrawn, distracted, less consistent in implementing household rules. This could be a temporary state that rectifies itself as the stress is resolved, but teens allowed to get away with murder for a period of time are likely to balk when the rules are enforced again. This may be what is causing your teenager to be defiant right now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.